Colorama, a recorded books hybrid imprint, presents How to Make Love to a Despot, an Alternative Foreign Policy for the 21st Century, by Stephen D. Krasner, read by David DeVries. Preface. Throughout its history, the United States has vacillated between two foreign policy models. One is an activist foreign policy designed to remake other countries in the United States' own image. The other foreign policy regards the rest of the world as essentially beyond repair, with the appropriate role for the United States being to demonstrate to other countries the benefits of consolidated democracy, including not only free and fair elections, but also a free press, the rule of law, separation of powers, and an active civil society, but not to actively try to create these results. Because groups or individuals with few resources can now kill thousands or hundreds of thousands of people, the United States no longer has the luxury of ignoring the rest of the world. But it cannot create consolidated democracies either. The United States must learn how to make love to despots. It should aim for good enough governance, not good government. Greater security, some economic growth, and the better provision of some services is the best the United States can hope for. During the 19th century, the United States was too weak to act far beyond its own borders. In the 20th century, the United States intervened in the First World War to make the world safe for democracy, in the words of President Wilson, but because of domestic opposition, refused to join the League of Nations or to sign the Versailles Treaty after the war. The United States then settled into splendid isolation while Germany and Japan rampaged across Europe and Asia. The United States entered the Second World War only after the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor. Before this attack, the America First movement, led by Charles Lindbergh and others, was politically stronger than those individuals, including the president, who wanted to join the nations fighting against the Axis powers. President Roosevelt seized on the Pearl Harbor attack to send American troops to North Africa, where they would engage German, not Japanese, forces. American leaders ended the Second World War convinced that hypernationalism and competitive economic closures were a threat to the security of the United States. They constructed an international order that was designed to prevent such threats in the future, an order that included multinational organizations like the United Nations, the International Monetary Fund, and the International Bank for Reconstruction and Development, the World Bank. American leaders were very successful in state building in Germany and Japan. Both countries eventually became democratic and market-oriented. An activist foreign policy could create consolidated democracy. When it became clear in 1947 that the Soviet Union would oppose the United States, materially and ideologically, American leaders supported elites in the Third World that would at least not take their countries down a communist path. Democracy was not a high priority. When the Soviet Union collapsed, and along with it the appeal of communism, American elites returned to what was a more natural instinct, remaking the world in the image of the United States. This was especially true after 9/11, when it became clear that weak, malign, and often badly governed states could threaten the security of the United States itself. The interventions in Afghanistan and Iraq have proved to be long and costly, and the administrations that followed that of George W. Bush have looked for ways to retreat from the broader Middle East. Officials as well as public opinion in general have become convinced that nothing can be done. A dystopian vision, in which the United States can do nothing, has been embraced by those on the left and the right. The greatest challenge for the United States now is to identify a set of policies that lie between the utopian vision that all countries can be like the United States, or at least some idealized version of America, and the dystopian view that nothing can be done. Americans would do well to begin with their own fraught history. The United States was the first major state to become a democracy. The Declaration of Independence was written at a time when all other major countries were monarchies. There was no guarantee that the United States would survive. It almost did not. The Civil War is still the costliest war in American history. The language of the Declaration of Independence soars. At the time of its writing, however, the United States was a slaveholding country. Slaves were counted as 3/5 of a person in the Constitution of the United States, which was written in 1787 to increase the population of slaveholding states. Slaves were about 20% of the population of the 13 states in 1776, even though slaves and slavery are not mentioned once in the Declaration of Independence. Racism still plagues the United States more than 240 years after independence was declared. The household income of African Americans is only about 50% of that of non-Hispanic whites. Rather than trying to make other countries consolidated democracies or doing nothing, this book argues the United States should aim for good enough governance. The best is often the enemy of the good. Pushing for free and fair elections may only get people killed. Trying to eliminate corruption entirely may preclude eliminating the worst form of corruption. The United States must learn how to deal with despots, because despotism is much more likely than consolidated democracy. Consolidated democracy is not the normal order of things. In most places in almost all of human history, elites in power have done everything that they could to stay in power. Power has meant material wealth and status, and power has usually come from the barrel of a gun or the point of an arrow, not from the voting box. Those who lose elections but have most of the guns will not go quietly into the night. Good enough governance would aim for security, better health, some limited economic growth, and perhaps some limited protection of human rights. It would complement rather than undermine the interests of elites in despotic polities. Good enough governance will be anathema to many groups in the United States, but it is feasible, and it would contribute to a world that is more secure and prosperous. I have come to understand that the problem of weak, fragile, and badly governed states has dominated most of my career, both within and outside of academia. In my early 20s, I was a Peace Corps volunteer in northern Nigeria. Many decades later, I worked at the State Department and National Security Council, thanks to the generosity and confidence of my friend and colleague, Condoleezza Rice. My time in government helped me to realize how many wise and competent people work for the federal government. Most governments are run entirely by professional civil servants. The American system allows for the presence of outsiders like myself. The many political appointments in the United States government do undoubtedly make for some degree of amateurism, but these appointments are also a conduit for new ideas. The United States has many failings, but no country has wielded such great power with so much wisdom. How to Make Love to a Despot. Chapter 1. So you want to make the world a better place. Police are everywhere, therefore be careful. They are out to fleece us and rob us of our last kopeck. Innkeeper in Boris Godunov, Act 1, Scene 4, by Modest Petrovich Mussorgsky. The United States has labored under a delusion. It has been a costly delusion, and it has hurt American national interests for 100 years. That delusion is that the world can be like us. We Americans have come to assume that democracy and material wealth are the natural order of things. We have assumed that the world, as President Wilson said in asking Congress for a declaration of war in April 1917, could be made safe for democracy. These words were echoed by President Bush nearly a century later in his transmittal letter for the 2002 National Security Strategy, which opened with the following sentence. The great struggles of the 20th century between liberty and totalitarianism ended with a decisive victory for the forces of freedom and a single sustainable model for national success: freedom, democracy, and free enterprise. When the rest of the world has failed to conform to American expectations, when America's utopian vision has not been realized, Americans have looked away, not comprehending why other countries have not adopted a model that seems to coincide so perfectly with human needs and desires. The concluding sentence of Donald Trump's transmittal letter of his first national security strategy, published in 2017, reads as follows: "We will remain a beacon of liberty and opportunity around the world." But at the same time, the Trump administration has embraced a dystopian view in which the United States can do nothing to improve conditions in other countries, even when American security is at risk. The United States has vacillated between active intervention to promote consolidated democracy and passive beckoning, the beacon on a hill, and it has been consistently disappointed. Weak and poorly governed states pose a threat to the United States. Modern technology has severed the relationship between underlying material resources and the ability to do harm. Millions of Americans could die as a result of actions taken by individuals in poorly governed and impoverished states because these individuals control nuclear or biological weapons. Pandemic diseases arising naturally in badly governed states could also kill millions of people in wealthier and more developed countries. The problem of governance cannot be solved through the creation of wealthy and democratic states, but it cannot be ignored either without threatening the material security of the more powerful. The United States could make itself and the world safer if it learned how to support policies that would be acceptable to despotic rulers, if it learned how to make love to despots. The best that can be hoped for is good enough governance, something that lies between the utopian vision of creating consolidated democracy and the dystopian view that nothing can be done about governance in other states. Governments capable of policing their own territory, generating some economic growth, and providing some basic services, especially those related to health, good enough governance can be supported by external actors. Corruption cannot be eliminated. Elections cannot be free and fair unless the distribution of votes matches the distribution of guns. In despotic states, there may be rule by law, but there will not be rule of law. The law will be used arbitrarily to punish those who threaten extant elites. American naivete about the possibilities for creating wealthy and democratic states has not been based on some simple-minded, atheoretical view of history. Rather, American policymakers have always been influenced by a widely held view of how development and democracy take place, namely, modernization theory. In this approach, wealth and democracy can be attained relatively easily. All that is necessary are population growth and technological change. If countries can find the first step of the up escalator, they can ride all the way to the top. American leaders have also been influenced, usually tacitly, by a second perspective on development, one that emphasizes institutional capacity. American leaders and those in other countries of the OECD, Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, have assumed that rulers in poorly governed states want to do the right thing. Their failures are the result of a lack of capacity rather than their desire to stay in power. This is a naive view of history and human nature. Wealth and democracy are not the natural order of things. They are, in fact, deeply unnatural. Despotic leaders do not want to provide benefits for those whom they govern. They want to support with arms or money those that can keep them in office. Wealthy democratic states have existed for only a short period of history, perhaps 150 years, in a few places in the world: North America, Western Europe, and parts of Asia. Despotism is not an aberration. The small number of states that have actually become wealthy democracies, states where political leaders can stay in power only by winning free and fair elections, have succeeded not because of structural conditions alone, but also because of luck. If the wind had blown in a different direction in June of 1588, the Spanish Armada might have been able to support the Duke of Parma's invasion force, which had been assembled in the Low Countries, then under Spanish rule. Queen Elizabeth I, a Protestant, would probably have been deposed. England would never have become the birthplace of the Industrial Revolution or the cradle of liberty. Catholicism would have become the official religion. If England had been invaded in 1588 rather than having the wealthy and democratic United Kingdom, we would all be speaking Spanish. If, in 1940, the waters of the English Channel had prevented the small boats from rescuing the British expeditionary force from Dunkirk, the British government might have sought peace, and Nazi Germany would have been able to devote all of its resources to the defeat of the Soviet Union. The outcome of the Second World War might have been very different, as would the world in which most humans now live. The Madisonian sweet spot, first described by Madison in Federalist 51, in which the government is strong enough to provide key services but does not repress its own population, has been achieved by a very few polities for a limited period of history. Since the Second World War, only one country has gone from being poor and autocratic to rich and democratic, South Korea. Most of the United States' interventions to create modern wealthy democracies have been failures, Afghanistan and Iraq being only the most recent examples. Because we Americans have assumed that everyone could be just like us, we have failed to identify any salient markers between Somalia and Denmark, between poverty, violence, and chaos, and wealth, peace, and order. We do not know how to make love to despots, even though most of the world is ruled by despotic regimes. Political leaders in non-democratic states will not accept changes that would threaten their ability to maintain power. Good enough governance is feasible, would protect American interests, and would not preclude changes that might ultimately lead to a more democratic system. It is hardly a revelation to point out that democracy, effective government, and a free market economy cannot usually be achieved by outside actors. Japan and Germany after the Second World War were aberrations made possible by the power of the United States, the delegitimization of fascist governments, and the existence of local members of the elite who saw being allied with the United States as the best alternative among difficult choices. The Marshall Plan worked in Western Europe, but the beneficiaries of the plan were already relatively wealthy and had some experience with democracy before the Second World War. Democracy was adopted by many of the former satellite states of Eastern and Central Europe after the collapse of the Soviet Union, not only because of the financial and ideological incentives that could be offered by the European Union, but also because extant regimes had been delegitimized. Communism had failed. Some of these countries, notably Hungary, are already backsliding. External actors can only see through the glass darkly. They are often oblivious to local power dynamics. Saddam Hussein was able to maintain power in Iraq for more than 20 years despite having completely miscalculated how long the 1980s war against Iran would last. He thought a few months at most, not years, and how the United States would react to his invasion of Kuwait in 1990. Only invasion by the United States in 2003 led to his ouster and execution. Stalin killed or imprisoned the wives and husbands of those close to him, but died a natural death. Even though Muammar Gaddafi died in a ditch, he stayed in power for more than 40 years. Good things do not always go together. Greater security may mean more violation of individual rights, including women's rights, and a limitation on the kinds of economic activities that would maximize individual well-being. No matter how much commitment the United States makes or how well coordinated its efforts are across the whole of government, the United States will fail if its goal is consolidated democracy, at least fail most of the time. Even if the best-intentioned international actors did not live in what Séverine Otisser has called peaceland, they would still not be successful because their objectives would be inconsistent with the interests of local elites. Despotic rulers will undermine or reject reforms that would weaken their hold on power. Humility. Homo sapiens have been on Earth for more than 150,000 years. For much of this period, they lived only in Africa. As they spread across the land masses of Earth, they initially formed small hunter-gatherer societies based on kinship groups. Only about 10,000 years ago did human beings begin to inhabit larger communities made possible by settled agriculture, which generated a surplus of food that could sustain groups of individuals, such as priests and rulers. The communities were governed by despotisms, usually hereditary, that maintained order through the arbitrary use of violence. Legitimacy was provided by tradition. These elites did not govern in the interests of the population as a whole. Their behavior and that of their minions was arbitrary and exploitative, as Mussorgsky so well captured in The Innkeeper's Lament from his opera Boris Godunov. Despots attended to the care and feeding of their own families, and sometimes not even that, and of those individuals or groups that controlled the instruments of violence. Throughout time, if individuals had the opportunity to run away from state control because, for instance, there was inaccessible mountainous terrain nearby in which to hide, they did so. Running away from the state meant less exploitation, more calories, and better health. Hobbes successfully captured our imagination. We fear the lack of effective government, but for most of human history, in almost all places, in almost all times, life has been nasty, brutish, and short, with or without effective governance. Madison wrote in Federalist 51, "If men were angels, no government would be necessary. If angels were to govern men, neither external nor internal controls on government would be necessary. In framing a government which is to be administered by men over men, the great difficulty lies in this. You must first enable the government to control the governed, and in the next place, oblige it to control itself." Only in the last century or two, in a small number of countries, have polities been created and sustained that solve the problem posed by James Madison. How is it possible to create institutions that are strong enough to govern and provide services and yet do not abuse individuals? Most people cannot access the legal system, even if on paper a modern legal system exists. Despots need corruption to get the resources that they need to stay in power. They engage in rent-seeking. That is, they create economic rules that allow them to steal more easily. More individuals cannot join together. They cannot form organizations because such organizations might threaten their despotic rulers economically or politically. Reaching the OECD world of rich and democratic states is extremely difficult and unusual. The most important virtue that external actors seeking to promote better governance can possess is humility. External actors should seek to promote good enough governance, not good governance. Good governance is based on a Western ideal in which the government delivers a wide variety of services to the population based on the rule of law, and the laws are determined by representatives selected through free and fair elections. Good governance will not be in the interests of national elites in most target states, which are closed access orders. Despots want to do what is good for them. Only in special circumstances will what is good for them be good for the society as a whole. External actors cannot be successful without the support of national elites, and national elites are usually despotic. They will at best support good enough governance, security, some service provision, some economic growth, because such policies will help them to stay in power. Most of the world's polities, perhaps 130 or so, are most easily understood as despotic. National elites and despotic polities will undermine efforts to create consolidated democracy or rule of law bureaucracies because the existence of such structures would mean their own political death. There are a small number of countries, perhaps 30 or so, that can be classified as intermediate polities, in which the interests of national political elites will be mixed. In intermediate political orders, those between open and closed access, different members of the national elite, or even the same individual, might be torn between initiatives that protect their own position and initiatives that are beneficial to the society as a whole. But even in intermediate polities, there is no guarantee that external actors trying to promote democracy, rule of law, and higher incomes will be successful. Not only will external actors have to support the right individuals in target states, those whose interests would best be served by an open access order in which rent seeking is limited or eliminated, but there is also an inescapable element of luck or unpredictability. Structural factors do not determine outcomes. Achieving the utopian vision is possible only in a small number of polities, and even in intermediate polities, there is no guarantee of success. False expectations. In the late summer of 1963, I boarded a chartered plane that was carrying more than 100 Peace Corps volunteers from New York City to Lagos, Nigeria. I was uncertain about going to graduate school, afraid to join the civil rights movement and face the racism and violence of the American South, happy to avoid the prospect of being drafted and sent off to Vietnam, but confident that my colleagues and I, mostly new college graduates, would make a positive contribution to Nigeria's future. John F. Kennedy's words in his inaugural address, "Ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country," rang true for me and for the other young Americans on that flight to Africa. We were American utopians. Nigeria had become independent from Britain in 1960. It had held democratic elections. The military was playing no obvious part in politics when I arrived. Even though regional, ethnic, and religious divisions were evident, there was no organized violence among groups or tribes. I was, however, assigned to teach history and English at a secondary school in the north, Adamawa Provincial Secondary School, because the regional government of northern Nigeria did not want to hire southern Nigerians, who were often Christian and definitely from a different tribe than the Fulanis and Hausas, almost all Muslim, who dominated the north. At one point, the several Peace Corps volunteers at the school were accused of proselytizing for Christianity. As a Jew, I felt more than comfortable rejecting the accusations being made against my colleagues and me, but I should have realized that something was amiss. I was, however, young and naive, an American utopian. With the end of British colonialism, my American colleagues and I imagined that Nigeria would do well, would become a prosperous, peaceful, democratic state. The Nigerians that I met after I arrived expected the same. With the yoke of colonialism lifted, everyone saw a bright future for Africa in general and in particular for Nigeria, sub-Saharan Africa's most populous state. Ethnic, religious, and tribal divisions were obviously salient. People looked and dressed differently and voted largely along regional and ethnic lines, but none of us Americans thought that these divisions would be a driver, perhaps the major driver, of Nigerian politics. I taught at Adamawa Provincial Secondary School for 2 years. The school itself, established by the British, was located halfway between the provincial capital of Yola, a traditional walled city where the Fulani emir lived, and the commercial center, Jimeta, which was located on the Benue River near the Cameroon border. The teaching staff consisted of Brits, Nigerians, American Peace Corps volunteers, and Pakistanis, the latter because the government of northern Nigeria preferred Muslims from South Asia rather than Christians from southern Nigeria, and there were many educated people in Pakistan. In the smallest of the small world moments that I have had, the son of one of the Pakistanis that I was teaching with, now a distinguished journalist in Karachi, participated in a summer program at Stanford in 2012. The principal of the school was a Brit, as were the provincial commissioner, a simulacrum of Colonel Blimp, and several other provincial department heads when I first arrived. Over the course of my 2 years, most were replaced by Nigerians. The school functioned well. Teachers always showed up for their classes. Classes were well taught, as far as I could see. Adamawa Provincial Secondary School was the only public high school in the whole province, and the selection of students, with a few exceptions, like the emir's son, appeared to me to be based on examination results. Some of our students went on to universities, at least one to graduate studies in the United States. One of our students, Atiku Abubakar, made a lot of money in the oil industry, was vice president of Nigeria from 1999 to 2007, and founded the American University of Nigeria in Yola in 2003. On the whole, things appear to be working pretty well. Within months after I left the country in the summer of 1965, military officers staged a coup. Within a year after I left, most of the people from the South that were living in Jimetta and its environs, primarily shopkeepers or federal civil servants, had been killed. In 1967, the southeast part of the country, where Nigeria's newly discovered oil was located, declared its independence, precipitating the Biafran Civil War. There were tens of thousands of battle deaths over the 3-year duration of the conflict. As an American utopian, I was surprised by all of this. Since the late 1960s, Nigeria has lurched through a series of military coups, had anemic economic growth, squandered its oil revenues, suffered from massive corruption at every level of government, and, in the area where I served, experienced an Islamic fundamentalist insurgency organized by a group called Boko Haram, which means, in Hausa, Western education is sinful. Nigeria's military, which at least on paper is very formidable, has had great difficulty containing and defeating Boko Haram. Even if we hadn't been young and naive, I do not believe that I or any of my colleagues, Nigerian or foreign, could have come close to predicting Nigeria's experience over the last 50 years. I could not have imagined the several decades-long closure of the railroad by which I traveled from the northern part of the country to the south on one of my school breaks. Nor do I think that in the early 1960s, many scholars or government decision-makers would have guessed at how wrong things would go. For almost all analysts and policymakers during the Cold War, the problem of the 20th century was not that modernity and progress could not be achieved, but that modernity could be perverted, Nazi Germany being the obvious case in point. For Americans after 1945, the major threat to the liberal democratic capitalist model was Soviet communism. Both communism and capitalism were ideologies of modernity, whose adherents expected that technology would be harnessed to progress, governments would effectively govern, and per capita incomes would rise. The Soviets, of course, denied human freedom and individual choice and presumed that progress could be effectively directed from the top through a more or less unconstrained bureaucratic apparatus. The Americans placed their faith in individual initiative, a limited state, and political and economic decisions that were made from the bottom. The Soviets beat the Americans into space in the late 1950s. Nixon's famous kitchen encounter with Khrushchev in Moscow in 1959 was a real debate. The Soviet Union and the communist system under which it was organized appeared to be a serious alternative to American capitalism and democracy. The fatal flaws in the Soviet system were hardly visible when I left for Nigeria in 1963. Fascism and communism were rationalized and legitimated by a high modernist ideology ostensibly grounded in rational thought. These modern autocracies killed tens of millions of their own citizens through domestic repression and the Holocaust, and tens of millions in other countries through war. The international institutions that were established at the end of the Second World War, the United Nations, the World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade, were initially motivated by a desire, especially in the United States, to prevent perversions of modernity, not to achieve it. Modernity, most Americans believed, would come with new technology and population growth. Rising incomes and democracy would naturally follow. The great challenge was to prevent the perversion of modernity, not to achieve it in the first place. Most Americans believed in a utopian vision in which consolidated democracy could be created relatively easily. What was not anticipated in the decades immediately following the Second World War was that many polities would not progress. The issue would not be which of two paths to modernity would be followed, communist autocracy or capitalist democracy, but rather whether any path to prosperity could be found at all. The prospect that economies could stagnate, that states would not be able to govern, that despotisms would be inefficient and exploitative, that there might be no effective state at all, that services could crumble, that despots would regard the polity's resources as an entitlement that could be pillaged for their own personal satisfaction and that of their close supporters, that civil conflict could afflict large numbers of states, that millions of people could become refugees or internally displaced persons, these were not trajectories that were seriously considered. It is very hard to get to Denmark. Denmark is a metaphor for a well-governed, wealthy state. Denmark was ranked number one in the World Happiness Report for 2016. Denmark's per capita income was almost $50,000, and its life expectancy reached 80 years. It is a full democracy. For most of human history, however, life has not been so benign. Homo sapiens have lived for about 8,000 generations. Increases in life expectancy for human beings began around 1850, only seven generations ago, and accelerated after 1900. For almost all of human history, life expectancy was below 30 years, although infant mortality explained much of this very low figure, while today it is in the high 70s or above for wealthy countries and approaching 70 for many poorer ones. Women, rich and poor, died in childbirth. Pandemic diseases, such as the Black Death that spread through Europe in the 14th century, might have killed half the population. In the Western Hemisphere, European conquerors used diseases to decimate the indigenous populations. For most people, regardless of their social rank, violence was endemic. Random murders and other forms of violence were not unusual. About one quarter of the English nobility died a violent death in the 14th century. Murder rates in Western Europe declined from about 20 to 40 per 100,000 in the 13th century to about 1 per 100,000 today. Western Europe became a world of wealthy democratic states only in the last part of the 20th century. Most human beings who have ever lived have done so under despotic regimes. The experience of people living in wealthy industrialized democracies since the end of the Second World War, with lives almost entirely free of violence, is the exception. The first half of the 20th century in Europe and Asia was soaked in violent death, perhaps 40 million casualties in the First World War and 80 million in the Second. Only in the last century or two has per capita income grown significantly. Angus Madison has estimated that world per capita income grew only very slowly from the year 1000 to 1820, at a rate of 0.05% a year from 1000 to 1500, and 0.07% a year from 1500 to 1820. Growth accelerated to 1.17% on average from 1820 to 1999 for all countries in the world. There was, however, significant variation in growth rates after 1820. The per capita compound growth rate in the now developed OECD West was 1.27% from 1820 to 1950, 3.64% from 1950 to 1973, and 1.80% from 1973 to 1995. In the rest of the world, the figures were 0.50% from 1820 to 1950, 2.89% from 1950 to 1973, and 1.38% from 1973 to 1995. The nature of some domestic political systems has become more variegated. Most of the OECD world is populated by full or consolidated democracies. Of the 36 members of the OECD, only 11 receive a polity score below the highest score of 10. Political authorities govern with the consent of the governed. They do not exploit or dominate. They cannot use violence in arbitrary ways. The rule of law is accessible, if not equally accessible, to all. These countries have reached the Madisonian sweet spot. Government is effective and constrained. In the past, only a few polities, such as the Greek city-states in the 5th and 4th centuries BC, the Italian city-states in the 14th and 15th centuries, and the Dutch Republic in the 16th century, approached anything like modern democracies where the arbitrary power of the state is constrained. Even in those societies, however, individual rights were much more limited than is the case in modern consolidated democracies, and these rights were enjoyed by only a fraction of the population. The Greeks, for instance, kept many slaves, and women did not vote. Consolidated democracy, or open access, or inclusive societies, ones in which the arbitrary power of the state is constrained, and in which almost all residents have access to the rule of law, is a recent and unique development in human history. It is worth quoting Josiah Ober at length. In his 2015 book entitled The Rise and Fall of Classical Greece, he writes in the preface, "I live in exceptional times. Democracy and growth define the normal, although not yet the usual, conditions of modernity. Autocracy, while still prevalent, is regarded as aberrant, so that most autocrats pretend to be democratic. Economic stagnation is seen as a problem that demands a solution. These conditions were not normal or even imaginable for most people through most of human history." Throughout human history, there have been only three ways in which societies have been organized: small foraging groups of perhaps 150 individuals, closed access or natural orders, and open access orders. In closed access orders, services are provided based on personal relationships with the elites. In open access orders, services are provided on the basis of impersonal entitlements accorded to citizens or residents. In closed access orders, the use of violence is controlled by elites and can be arbitrary. In open access orders, violence is constrained by the rule of law and is in the hands of an organized security apparatus that is controlled by legally authorized public authorities. These authorities, if they abuse their power, can be dismissed by a broad coalition of citizens. In closed access orders, only some members of the society, elites, have the right to form organizations. In open access societies, all members of the society have the right to form organizations. In closed access societies, only some individuals, members of the elite, can compete for office. In open access societies, anyone can compete for office. In closed access societies, elites can create rents by restricting the right to form organizations and to engage in exchange. In open access societies, it is more difficult for elites to create rents because rents can be competed away by newly created organizations. The political and economic spheres are intimately linked. In closed access orders, the political elite is constrained, if at all, not by the rule of law or accountability to a broader public, but by a balance of power among elites. Despots can use violence, confiscation, and arbitrary changes in rules to seize economic assets. If there is political order in a closed access society, economic growth is possible, but it will be more erratic and cannot be sustained over the long term. Economic growth can be sustained only if individuals have incentives to invest and if political elites have no choice but to accept the changes in the distribution of political power generated by creative destruction in the economic sphere. If any successful venture can be confiscated or shut down by political authorities, if individuals can be killed, sustained investment will not take place. That despots would want to pursue policies that keep them in power, that provide them with deference, status, and wealth, is hardly surprising. What is surprising is an incentive system that would reward political elites not for feeding their own families or for paying off those in control of the means of violence, but for serving the best interests of the society as a whole. There is no teleological trajectory, no natural and inevitable path from extractive or closed access orders to inclusive or open access orders. In the modern world, some elements of technology, especially those related to health, have resulted in impressive improvements in the control of some diseases, infant mortality, and life expectancy. These improvements have been experienced across a very wide range of polities. But sustained economic growth and consolidated democracy have been more elusive. Elites operating in a closed order or extractive society will not necessarily have an incentive to expand rights, to make themselves accountable to the rule of law, to limit opportunities for rent-seeking, or to constrain their own use of violence. Just the opposite. In a closed access or extractive polity, the loss of political power means the loss of status, wealth, and possibly life. Death in a ditch, the fate that befell Muammar Gaddafi, is more likely than the golden parachute that landed Idi Amin in Saudi Arabia. Although almost all of the countries that have achieved consolidated democracy are in Western Europe, East Asia, and North America, this endpoint was not foreordained by geography or culture. Rather, it was the result of a series of lucky accidents that encouraged elites to move toward a more inclusive, open-access order. We cannot assume that consolidated democracy is a natural stopping point from which regression is impossible. Organizational structures can atrophy, and institutional arrangements locked in by constitutional rules that can be changed only by supermajorities can become dysfunctional because they were created to address different problems in a different era. The United States Senate, for instance, has become less and less representative over time as the ratio between the smallest and largest state populations has grown from about 1 to 13, Delaware to Virginia in 1787, to 1 to 69, Wyoming to California in 2018. Even in full democracies, public policy may fail to address pressing issues because political decision-making is skewed by neo-patrimonialism, in which moneyed elites are more and more able to determine political outcomes, or by the fact that, at least in the United States, the members of Congress are hardwired by electoral incentives to be responsive to the interests of their districts or states and not to the interests of the United States as a whole. In 1963, my fellow Peace Corps volunteers and I, policymakers and academics, assumed, sometimes tacitly, a natural progression in human affairs. We were American utopians. We were wrong. Getting to Denmark is hard. Understanding how rich and democratic states got to be rich and democratic is the greatest challenge for the social sciences. The most convincing argument, rational choice institutionalism, focuses on the incentives and strategic behavior of elites. Transitions from despotic to more open polities, in which political leaders have an incentive to promote the well-being of the society as a whole, or at least a large part of it, are never instantaneous. Polities do not move from extractive, exploitative institutions to the Madisonian sweet spot overnight. There are intermediate or transitioning polities, but this group is relatively small. Rational choice institutionalism provides a more convincing picture than do the other two major theoretical perspectives on development that have been explicitly identified by scholars and implicitly embraced by policymakers: modernization theory and theories of institutional capacity. All three of these approaches are discussed more thoroughly in chapters 3 and 4. Development, domestic authority structures, and external state building. The most important foreign policy objective has always been national security, the preservation of the territorial and political integrity of the state. The greatest threats to national security have historically come from the most powerful states, those that commanded the largest material resources and could deploy the most formidable military forces. The most common modalities have involved state-to-state relations, including diplomacy, sanctions, and war. The international system is, however, anarchical. There is no authoritative actor that can prevent one state from pursuing its foreign policy objectives by trying to alter the domestic authority structures, leaders, or domestic political forces in another state. Efforts to alter domestic authority structures are challenging. They are relatively rare, but they have always been a policy option. There were about 200 cases of forcible regime change, the most extreme form of external state building, from 1555 to 2010. Fewer than one every 2 years, but in absolute terms, not a small number. The hot wars that the United States fought during the Cold War against Vietnam and Korea were primarily about the kind of domestic authority structures these two countries would have. Much of the foreign assistance that was dispersed during the Cold War was designed to support or bribe leaders that would ally their countries with the West or the East. Covert or overt interventions by the United States between 1945 and 1990 were designed not to conquer territory, but to influence domestic political arrangements, often just arrangements at the top. The Soviet Union imposed communist regimes on the countries that it occupied at the end of the Second World War, or incorporated these countries into the Soviet Union itself, as was the case for the three Baltic countries. Leaders in both the Soviet Union and the United States understood that if in the long term the overwhelming balance of regime types in the world became either communist or democratic and capitalist, it would pose a threat to the domestic integrity of the superpower that was losing this global struggle. With the collapse of the Soviet Union, the menace of communism disappeared for the West, and the project of democracy promotion, broadly understood to include, for instance, human rights, became more consequential, especially for the United States and Western Europe. Democracy promotion was a more ambitious agenda than simply the support of regimes, autocratic or not, that supported the West. After 1990, a major goal, perhaps the major goal, of the European Union was to transform the former satellite states of the USSR through the appeal of membership, which involved both material and ideational attractors. The United States could put more emphasis on supporting transitions to democratic regimes because it no longer had to be concerned about bolstering autocratic rulers who might align their countries with the Soviet Union. Most countries, however, remained despotisms with or without the Soviet Union. Outside of Europe, though, there was not much urgency to these projects. Development assistance, only a small part of which was committed to political reform that included democratization, from all of the OECD countries, fell from $91 billion in 1992 to $73 billion in 1997. Aid from the United States dropped from $17 billion to $9 billion for the same period, or from 0.2% to 0.1% of gross national income. The benign period in which foreign policy was of limited concern for American leaders lasted, however, for only about a decade. It ended with the attacks of 9/11. I began working at the State Department as a member of the policy planning staff at the beginning of September 2001. I had spent the previous 35 years in academia. I was anxious for exposure to the policy world, and the appointment of my Stanford colleague and friend Condoleezza Rice as National Security Advisor provided an opportunity. Despite the bombings of the U.S. embassies in Kenya and Tanzania in 1998 and the attack on the USS Cole in Yemen in October of 2000, few in the policy world or academia expected that America's conception of the world was about to be transformed. 9/11 was a shattering event, especially for anyone living in New York or Washington. After I left the State Department building on the morning of 9/11, I biked over to the Potomac, a short ride from State, to look at the Pentagon burning across the river. I thought about trying to get closer, but decided that it would be too painful. George W. Bush had expected that his administration would be focused on domestic issues. 9/11 transformed that focus, but did not dictate the nature of the response. The administration framed the problem of transnational terrorism in a very ambitious way, associating it with repressive regimes, especially in the Arab world, and developed a coherent grand strategy consistent with this framing that was articulated in the National Security Strategy of 2002. This framing was completely consistent with America's utopian vision. The 2002 National Security Strategy of the United States of America offered a coherent approach for addressing the threat of transnational terrorism. It identified the crossroads of radicalism and technology as the gravest danger to American security. It argued that the United States and its allies would have to redefine the conventional understanding of imminent threat and preemptive war because transnational terrorists would not engage in the visible mobilization of armed forces. President Bush wrote in his letter introducing the strategy that the events of September 11, 2001 taught us that weak states like Afghanistan can pose as great a danger to our national interests as strong states. Islamic radicalism was understood as a product of political repression, especially in the Arab world. In the long run, it was a challenge that could be addressed only by the spread of democracy and freedom. In an essay published in Foreign Affairs at the end of the administration, Condoleezza Rice, who had been Bush's national security advisor and secretary of state, and for whom I worked as director of policy planning, argued that the United States does not have permanent allies, the nations with whom we share common values. While recognizing that there could be tensions between democracy and security in the short term, she argued that in the long term, our security is best ensured by the success of our ideals: freedom, human rights, open markets, democracy, and the rule of law. The administration's ambitions were hardly aberrant. Like all of his predecessors, Bush argued that the United States had to support freedom and democracy. The idea of spreading democracy has always been part of American foreign policy, although sometimes only discernible in rhetoric. The temptation to make values and regime change relatively more prominent is greater when a state has more power, and the United States occupied an unchallenged position at the beginning of the first decade of the 21st century. Had the United States been more constrained, had its material resources been more limited, its leaders might have opted for less ambitious goals. They might have focused more on immediate security concerns and less on democratization, even if they believed that democratization was the key to American security in the long run. I worked at the National Security Council in 2001 and 2002, and then as Director of Policy Planning at the State Department from 2005 to 2007. While the ambitions of the Bush administration may look excessive in retrospect, in prospect, they appeared, at least to me, to be entirely reasonable. At the beginning of the 21st century, the United States had overweening power. Democracy appeared to be on the rise around the world. Francis Fukuyama had written about the end of history in 1989, arguing that democracy and free markets were the only fully legitimated path to prosperity and human well-being. The Soviet Union had self-destructed. The Berlin Wall had fallen. After the collapse of the Soviet Union, the states of Eastern Europe, with significant incentives and assistance from the European Union, had become democracies, in some cases consolidated democracies. The idea that the United States could plant democracy, or at least the seeds of democracy, in the Middle East did not appear to be far-fetched. A potent new threat made manifest on 9/11 had arisen. Because of the nexus of alienated and radicalized groups, especially those motivated by Salafist Islam, and weapons of mass destruction, nuclear or biological, the security of even the most powerful nations might be at risk from groups protected by or finding safe harbor in malevolent, badly governed, or failed states. Of the 15 states with the highest, worst scores on Foreign Policy Magazine's 2010 Failed State Index, 9 were majority Muslim countries. Zimbabwe might be ignored. Somalia, Pakistan, and Yemen cannot be. Terrorists may come from many different backgrounds. A grandchild of a Jewish doctor raised by hippie parents in Riverside County west of Los Angeles became a spokesman for Al-Qaeda. A college-educated American citizen of Pakistani origin tried to set off a car bomb in Times Square. Terrorism, including terrorism motivated by Salafist Islam, may arise in the United States itself. Syed Rizwan Farooq, an American-born son of Pakistani parents, who graduated from Cal State San Bernardino and worked for the San Bernardino County Department of Health, killed 14 people at the Inland Regional Center in San Bernardino in December 2015. His wife, who participated in the attack, was born in Pakistan, had lived in Saudi Arabia, and had studied in Pakistan. Even if failing states are not the only source of terrorism, they are one venue within which terrorists can be radicalized and seek refuge. Salman Abedi, who killed 22 people in a suicide bombing at a concert in Manchester, was born in England of Libyan parents but had recently returned from Libya. Failing states with many alienated young men can be hospitable environments for training camps, and trained terrorists are more likely to be successful. Safe havens provide venues where extremists can seek refuge, indoctrinate, and train without fear of disruption. Attacks with weapons of mass destruction, not just conventional explosives, could result in many deaths. Biological weapons will become easier to fabricate. Natural pathogens could occur in a state with limited governance capacity and increase among the local population for many years before spreading to the advanced industrialized world. Such pathogens would cause limited but hardly trivial damage if transmission was difficult, as has been the case of AIDS and Ebola, but could cause millions of deaths if they could be transmitted through the air rather than by human fluids. Even AIDS, which is not transmitted that easily, has killed, according to the World Health Organization, about 35 million people. Nuclear weapons are not beyond the reach of ISIS, Al-Qaeda, Hezbollah, or some other group, given the nuclear programs in Pakistan, Iran, North Korea, and elsewhere. Advanced industrialized democratic societies are confronted with a world of uncertainty rather than risk, a world in which there might be black swans. Very destructive events may take place, but it is impossible to know with any confidence what their underlying probability distribution might be. States or non-state groups with relatively limited resources, but possessing nuclear or biological weapons, could kill thousands or hundreds of thousands of individuals residing within the boundaries of much more powerful states. Terrorist groups, national or transnational, could also inflict levels of death and destruction that have in the past.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.